I know, right? Too much trouble. Lo beli sebox, nggak habis hati ya.
Oke, okay, saudara-saudara, kita akan segera memulai. We shall start. Pelajaran hari ini saya berutang pada istri saya. Today's lesson I owe a great deal to my wife. Karena saya itu lupa bahwa kita ini harus memulai pelajaran yang baru, saya pikir masih ada halaman berikutnya. Because I forgot that actually I had to prepare for a new material for today. I thought we just use the second page. Tadi kira-kira jam 6 kurang, Santi berkata, Paul, kita akan belajar yang baru ya. Saya bilang, enggak, yang minggu lalu, halaman berikutnya. She asked me, Paul, we're going to start a new material today, right? New page. I said, no, we're still using the same page, the other side. Terus saya bilang, udah, saya cek dulu dah. Benar saja, saya salah, dia benar. After I check, of course, she was right, I was wrong. Jadi jam 6 pagi saya langsung selesaikan. I have to be here at 8 o'clock because I have counseling. Jadi kalau sampai ada yang salah, mohon dimaafkan lahir dan batin. Mari kita masuk dalam doa, let us pray. Bapa dalam surga, terima kasih kami boleh berkumpul dan belajar firman-Mu pada siang hari ini. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that today you have gathered us together to study your word. Biarlah Engkau ajarkan kami supaya kami mengerti kehendak-Mu. Please teach us, Lord, that we may understand your will. Dalam nama Tuhan Yesus kami berdoa. In the name of Jesus we all pray. Amen. Mari kita buka kitab Yosua pasal 2 ayat 1 dan 2. Please turn your Bible to the book of Joshua chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 2. Kitab Yosua pasal 2, ayat 1 dan 2. Joshua chapter 2, verse 1 and verse 2. Mari kita membacanya bersama-sama, 1, 2, 3. Yosua bin Nun dengan diam-diam melepas dari Sitim dua orang pengintai, katanya, "Pergilah, amat-amatilah negeri itu dan kota Yeriko." Maka pergilah mereka dan sampailah mereka ke rumah seorang perempuan sundal yang bernama Rahab, lalu tidur di situ. Kemudian diberitahukanlah kepada Raja Yeriko demikian, "Tadi malam ada orang datang kemari dari orang Israel untuk menyelidik negeri ini." Mari kita masuk halaman 7, page 7. Apa yang dilihat dan dipelajarinya dari Musa, itulah yang dilakukannya. Tambahkan kata, dilakukannya. Whatever Joshua saw and learned from Moses, that's what he did. 40 tahun sebelumnya, Musa mengutusnya bersama dengan Caleb dan 10 orang lainnya untuk mengintai tanah Kanaan. As you recall, 40 years ago, Moses sent him with Caleb and 10 other people to spy the land of Canaan. Sekarang ia melakukan hal yang sama. Ia mengutus dua pengintai ke Yeriko. And see, today he is doing exactly the same thing. He is sending two spies to Jericho. Nah, kita tidak tahu alasan Yosua hanya mengirim dua pengintai, padahal sebelumnya Musa mengutus 12 pengintai. We don't know the reason why Joshua only sent two spies, because before Moses sent 12 spies. Namun kita dapat menduganya. But I think we can make an educated guess. Mungkin Yosua belajar dari pengalamannya yang lalu. Yaitu apa? 12 pengintai berarti 12 pendapat. Dua pengintai berarti dua pendapat. Betul sekali, tambahkan dua pendapat. So maybe this is what he learned from his previous experience. 12 spies means what? 12 opinions. Two spies means two opinions. Nah, mana yang lebih gampang kita hadapi?
Dua.
It's a lot easier to deal with two different opinions than 12. Dari sini dapat kita petik satu pelajaran, yaitu kita perlu belajar dari kesalahan, betul sekali, di masa lalu. So from this we can glean a lesson, and that is we need to learn from our past mistakes. Jangan kita mengulanginya lagi. So do not repeat the mistake that we have committed. Jauh lebih baik menghindar dari masalah daripada menyelesaikan masalah. You see, it is far better to avoid getting into a problem than try to solve a problem. Yeah, avoidance is always better than solving a problem. Perlu usaha dan pengorbanan yang lebih besar untuk menyelesaikan masalah. We all know it requires much more effort and sacrifices to solve a problem. Akibat laporan dan hasutan 10 pengintai, Israel mesti membayar mahal. We remember the story, yeah? Because of these 10 spies who disagreed, who refused to enter the land of Canaan, Israel paid a great price. Selama 40 tahun mereka mengembara di padang gurun. For 40 long years they wandered in the desert. Yosua belajar dari kesalahan, itulah ciri pemimpin yang bijak. Tambahkan kata bijak. You see, Joshua learned from the mistake, and that is the quality of a wise leader. Stop dulu. Saudara, tebak mulai kapankah tentara Nazi Jerman mengalami kekalahan dalam Perang Dunia Kedua. Can you tell me since when or where the Nazi Germany began to suffer defeat during the Second World War II? Second World War. Di kota Leningrad. You're right. It happened actually in the Soviet Union, specifically in the city of Leningrad. Nah, saudara, cuaca di sana begitu dingin. Jadi waktu tentara Nazi Jerman masuk, yang dilakukan oleh tentara Soviet di Leningrad adalah membakar tempat persediaan makanan. You see, the weather was treacherous, yeah. The winter was really bad in Soviet Union. So, when the Nazi Germany came, what the Soviet soldiers did was they actually destroyed or burned the food storage. Jadi waktu mereka datang, saudara, tidak ada lagi persediaan makanan. So when they arrive, no more food. Dan mereka lama mati-matian sehingga terus bertahan di sana, tentara-tentara Nazi Jerman, kelaparan dan kedinginan. Banyak yang mati. They fought really hard, the Soviet Union, the Soviet soldiers fought very hard, and they were able to actually hold the Nazi German soldiers from advancing, and they're stuck there in Leningrad. No food and cold. Many of them died there. Thousands of Nazi Germany soldiers died. Of course, we also know thousands of Soviet soldiers and civilians also died in the war. But that was the beginning of their defeat. That was the beginning of their defeat. Nah, saudara, ini yang menarik. Sebelumnya Hitler memutuskan menyerang Soviet, military advisors-nya sudah memberi dia nasihat, jangan serang. Kenapa? Belajarlah dari Napoleon. Napoleon begitu juga dulu. Serang Soviet, kalah karena kedinginan semuanya. The military advisors advised against that idea to attack Soviet Union. But Hitler did not listen. He thought he knew better. They said, look, learn from Napoleon. Napoleon suffered defeat there because of the weather. It was so treacherous, it's so cold. Tapi saudara, Hitler did not pay attention and he suffered defeat. Jadi ya kita ngerti sekarang ya, seorang pemimpin yang bijak selalu belajar dari kesalahan masa lalu. Ya, a wise leader always learn from the mistakes done in the past by others or themselves. Mari kita sambung. Kota Jericho adalah kota tua. The city of Jericho is a very old city. Orang sudah mulai datang dan menetap di wilayah itu sekitar 9000 sebelum Masehi. Yeah, so people had actually begun to come and settle in that land about 9000 before Christ or BC. Jadi kota tua sekali. Dan yang menjadikan kota itu kuat dan tak terkalahkan adalah tembok. Betul sekali. Tambahkan kata tembok. Yang mengelilinginya. Kokoh dan tinggi, tidak dapat ditembus. And what made that city is so strong, yeah, impenetrable, is because of the wall. So they built really thick and high wall. So nobody ever succeeded in conquering Jericho simply because of the wall. Kita tahu inilah yang dicoba dilakukan oleh siapa? Qin Shi Huang. Shi Huang Ti ya. Yang membangun the Great Wall di China. Itu tujuannya saudara ya. Kenapa Kaisar Huang membangun tembok di China adalah untuk melindungi diri dari serangan bangsa-bangsa lain. Ya, tembok yang besar-besar, banyak di antara saudara yang sudah pernah ke sana ya. Sudah lihat seperti apa temboknya. Nah, tembok kota Jericho seperti itu. So the wall in Jericho is also like that, thick and high, impenetrable. Nobody has ever succeeded in destroying the city of Jericho simply because of the wall. Okay? Bangsa lain tidak pernah berhasil dan mengalahkan Jericho. Sekarang kita lebih mengerti mengapa Yosua gentar. Now we understand why Joshua was so scared. Proyek pertamanya adalah menembus pertahanan Jericho. Tugas yang mustahil secara manusiawi. You know, the first project God gave him after God ordained him to replace Moses is to penetrate this wall. Ya, jadi aduh kenapa kok tugas pertama baru belajar mustahil dilakukan. You know, this is his new job as a leader, his new assignment, and God gave him this impossible assignment. Nah, namun karena Tuhan sudah berjanji bersamanya dan menyuruhnya untuk masuk, ia taat dan menjadi berani. But because God has promised to be with him, and God has instructed him to go, to march in, he obeyed, and he became brave. He was of courage. Nah, dari sini dapat kita petik satu pelajaran, yakni iman lahir dari ketaatan, bukan dari keberanian. Tambahkan kata keberanian. Okay, this is an important lesson for us to learn. Faith comes from obedience. Faith comes not from courage. Menghadapi tugas yang maha besar dan mustahil, siapapun akan merasa gentar. It doesn't matter who, but when we are faced with this impossible, yeah, project, we are going to be afraid. Terbayang di mata bukan kemenangan, melainkan kekalahan yang akan diraih. So what crossed Joshua's mind for sure, if he that did not have that strength from God, was defeat, not victory. Namun Yosua beriman sebab Tuhan telah berjanji bersamanya, dan ia taat, tambahkan kata taat, kepada perintah Tuhan yang menyuruhnya masuk. But Joshua had faith because God had made that promise to be with him, and so he obeyed God's command. Di dalam menghadapi hidup, jangan kita menunggu iman baru taat. So in life, do not wait for faith to come before we obey God. Kita taat terlebih dahulu baru beriman, tambahkan kata beriman. We obey first and then we will have faith. Makin taat, makin kita beriman. So the more obedient we are, the more faith we will have. Saudara, jadi ini menjelaskan ya kepada kita ya, sebetulnya tuh yang Tuhan minta tidak susah sebetulnya. If we can understand this, we can understand that what God asks of us actually is not too much. Kadang kita berpikirkan Tuhan meminta kita sesuatu yang tak mungkin kita lakukan, mustahil. Sometimes we think, God, you're asking me to do something that is impossible to do. Nah, Tuhan hanya minta kita satu, lakukan saja. Just obey me. That's what he has asked of. Just obey me. Waktu kita obey, kita menaati, tiba-tiba kita melihat Tuhan bekerja, mewujudkan yang tadinya itu mustahil. When we obey, will we then see the reality of God's promise, of God's word, that this is happening? Nah, makin kita melihat, oh, gara-gara taat Tuhan melakukannya, kita makin hari makin mempunyai iman. Yeah. So the more we obey God, the more faith we will grow. Jadi jangan tunggu iman dulu datang, jangan berkata saya nggak punya iman sebab Tuhan belum berikan saya iman kok. Ya pokoknya Tuhan kalau berikan saya iman baru saya akan lakukan. No, that's the other way around. Yeah. So do not say I'm gonna wait for God to give me faith before I do this. If He doesn't give me faith, then I won't do it because what for? I don't have the faith. That's the wrong way to approach this. God only asks, just do it. Itu yang Tuhan minta. Lakukan. Iman akan muncul gara-gara engkau taat. Yeah, faith will come because you obey me. That's what always God's word to us. Kita sambung lagi. Let's go on. Dua pengintai masuk ke Yeriko dan memilih untuk menginap di rumah seorang pelacur bernama Rahab. So these two spies enter Jericho and they choose to spend the night in the house of a prostitute. Perempuan sundal itu adalah artinya perempuan pelacur. Ya. Mungkin kita bertanya-tanya, mengapakah mereka memilih menginap di rumah seorang pelacur? Yeah, especially the ladies would be asking this question. Why did God tell this man to spend the night in this prostitute's house? Dan gak ada orang yang akan percaya karena Tuhan menyuruh saya ke sana. And I bet nobody would believe them if they said, God asked me to. Yeah. Nah, saudara, nah tapi ini ya, kita akan melihat alasannya. Let's see the reason. Sekali lagi kita melihat hikmat di sini. Once again, we see a pearl of wisdom. Hikmat. Pelacur bukanlah orang terpandang. Jadi kecil kemungkinan orang akan memperhatikan Rahab dan siapa saja yang datang ke tempatnya. Kecuali para istri-istri yang lagi cari suaminya ya. Yang lain gak akan cari-cari ke sana. You see, a prostitute is not an honorable member of society. So, very little chance that people will pay attention to Rahab. And very, very, very little chance that people would want to know who go in and out of her home. Except their wives who are looking for their husbands. Kedua, pelacur melayani siapapun. Jadi, pemandangan orang asing keluar masuk rumahnya adalah sesuatu yang biasa. Betul, tambahkan kata biasa. You guys know so much about prostitution. Yeah, a prostitute serves anyone who can pay them, of course, yeah. So the sight of people go in and out of their house is something that is normal, usual. Nah, jadi saudara kita bisa katakan dua pengintai yang diutus Yosua ternyata adalah dua orang yang cerdas dan bijak. So we can say that these two spies sent by Joshua turn out to be two brilliant and wise men. Strategi yang baik dan orang yang tepat. Tambahkan kata orang. A good strategy and the right person. Orang yang tepat. Inilah resep keberhasilan. This is recipe for success. A good strategy and the right person to do it. Recipe for success. Seharusnya kedua pengintai ini dapat melakukan tugasnya dengan baik tanpa diketahui oleh siapapun. Supposedly these two spies could do their job well, and nobody would be able to uncover their identities. Namun ternyata ada yang tahu bahwa mereka berdua adalah orang Israel yang datang untuk mengintai. But somehow somebody found out that these two guys are actually Israelites who have come to spy on them. Kita tidak tahu siapa atau bagaimana ya. We don't know who and we don't know how they found out. Dan orang itu melaporkannya kepada Raja Yeriko, and that person report that to the king of Jericho. Dari sini dapat kita petik satu pelajaran, yaitu sebaik apapun rencana dan strategi kita, dan sebaik apapun sumber daya yang kita miliki, semua ini tidak menjamin hasil, tambahkan kata hasil, yang baik. So let's learn a lesson here. It doesn't matter how well our preparation is. It doesn't matter how good our strategy is. And it doesn't matter how prepared our manpower is. All this is no guarantee of a good outcome. Selalu ada faktor X yang dapat mengobrak-abrik rancangan yang baik. There is always that X factor that can mess up a good plan. Nah, ini pelajarannya buat kita. Itu sebab kita harus selalu bersandar pada Tuhan. Tambahkan kata bersandar. It is therefore we ought to lean on God. Bersandar pada Tuhan. Manusia merencanakan tetapi Tuhan menentukan. Betul, tambahkan kata menentukan. Man may plan, but God will determine. So, man proposes, God disposes, always. Propose, dispose. Jadi jangan takabur dengan strategi dan sumber daya baik yang kita miliki. Ya, do not boast, do not be arrogant with what we have, with resources that we have, the good strategy that we have. No, do not. Tuhan dapat mengirim angin dan membelokkan arah. God can send the wind and deviate the direction that we have taken. Selalu bergantunglah pada Tuhan dan serahkan keinginan kita kepada-Nya. So depend on God and surrender all our wills, our wishes to Him. Okay. Will somebody please turn the camera off, please? Thank you.